whether an intervention in the market or a market failure is actually good or a bad thing, we wanted to see what the welfare consequences are of doing it. So price, quantity. I'm again going to draw my nice linear demand curve here. Demand, 2, 4, 5. This here's marginal revenue. And I'm going to draw my marginal cost curve linear. You can draw U-shapes if you want, but I'm just going to draw it linear because it makes my life easier. So remember that demand is just price as a function of quantity. So the socially optimal output level is where price equals marginal cost. So price is demand, right? Price is a function of quantity. Marginal cost is marginal cost. So the welfare maximizing output level is right here, which is not what the monopolist is going to produce. So this here is going to be 2 star, and this here is going to be 2 star. Where does the monopolist produce? The monopolist sets marginal cost equal to marginal revenue, figures out this quantity right here, that's going to be Qm, and then goes up to the demand curve and charges that price. So before I even go ahead and draw my welfare table and figure all this stuff out, what does the monopolist do? The monopolist charges a price higher than the socially efficient outcome marginal cost equals price, okay? And a quantity that's lower than 2 star. So we showed this completely generically when we first started talking about consumer and producer surplus. If you produce less than 2 star, there's deadweight loss. If you produce more than 2 star, there's deadweight loss. So producing more than was really hard, but producing less than was easier. But what we've got here is a scenario where a firm produces less than where price equals marginal cost, right? So there's got to be deadweight loss here. And the answer to that is going to be, yes, you're absolutely right. So let's show that for us, okay? So a nice little welfare table, consumer surplus, producer surplus, welfare. So 2 star. Let's make some pizza slices again. This big triangle is A, this rectangle here B, this whole thing here C, this here D, and this here E. So let's do 2 star, P star first. Consumer surplus, area between demand and price charge over the range of consumption, right? So we're consuming 2 star, price is P star, this is demand. So consumer surplus is A, B, and D. Producer surplus, difference between price and marginal cost over the range of production. So this here is price, production is 2 star, this is marginal cost, so P plus E. So welfare is going to be A plus B plus C plus D plus E. Now let's see what happens. At the monopoly output. Monopoly price is going to be PM, output is going to be QM, so consumer surplus is the distance between demand, price charged by the monopolist over the range of consumption, so it's going to be A. Producer surplus, now remembering that the monopolist is only producing QM, price charged is PM, so distance between price, marginal cost over the range of production is going to be B plus C, so welfare is A, B, C. We used to have A, B, C, D, and E, now we have A, and A, B, and C, so we lose D, we lose E, and that's going to be my deadweight loss here. Do consumers like monopolists? Nope. We used to have A, B, D, now have A. So minus B, minus C. ABD also stands for all that dissertation, which all the graduate students in the back of the room are, right? No, not quite, almost. All right, producer surplus. Producers used to have C and E. Now they have B and C. So they gain B, but they lose E. So B is transferred consumer surplus to producers, right? So producers capture B from consumers. D is lost consumer surplus, and E is lost consumer surplus. So if you look at the area here, B is a much bigger chunk than E, so producers like this, right? But the big important thing here overall is that the monopolist generates deadweight loss here, where welfare is lost by having the monopolist be allowed to make his profit maximizing decision. So if you leave the monopolist alone, operating in the market, and say, yo, monopolist, you do whatever you want, right? I don't care. What you will end up with is a monopolist who produces his profit maximizing output level, which happens to be lower than the socially optimal output level, and you get the resulting deadweight loss, a really high price, and a lower quantity than you would want to maximize welfare. Okay. Well, Max, you're an economist, right? You guys love taxes, so I bet you the answer to this is going to be a tax. Microsoft, bad. I have this awesome picture. One of my friend's labs in this building uses this giant box of Microsoft products at a doorstop. So these products are interesting. Was a really old one. But taxing a monopolist, and for the record, in case any lawyers are listening to this live feed, I don't mean Microsoft to be a monopolist. You're not, right? You're an oligopolist, but semantics. All right. Maybe the intuitive answer here is we should just tax them, right? They're bad monopolists. They're making these excess profits, so we should tax this stuff. So let's see what happens if you tax a monopolist. This is demand, right? Function of quantity. I mean, this is getting boring already because you're so good at drawing marginal revenue. Right? This is marginal revenue. And I'm going to stick with my sort of very simple here. Very simple marginal cost curve. So we know that the socially optimal output level is this one here. That here is 2 star. What will the monopolist actually produce? Well, the monopolist will produce where marginal cost equals marginal revenue. This output level here, Qm. And the price he will charge is this. So this is what we just drew. Now we're going to charge a specific tax. All right, we're going to charge a specific tax because that's got to be the right answer. So let's charge a specific tax now. So what a specific tax does, of course, you remember this, shift up marginal cost plus tau. So what does the profit maximizing firm do? It just sets its new marginal cost curve equal to marginal revenue. And the monopolist now produces CM tau. What happens, Max? Did you make it better or did you make it worse? You made it way worse, right? Because what happens now? What the tax does is it raises price even further and it shifts quantity in even further, right? So before, if you allow me to sketch a little bit here, this here was deadweight loss before tax, And if we went through the whole exercise right here, after tax, you're adding this green area. This is not a friendly green. This is a very hostile green. Additional dead weight loss after tax. So by taxing a monopolist, you're actually making things worse. Okay, I'm going to give away some money. That means I can't buy a sandwich after class, but this is worth $2. See if you're the sort of mentally corrupted economist that I hope you've become now. So while the tax makes it worse, and raise your hand for $2, what seems like a good, so you know, if you're moving further away from where you want to be, what other policy option would maybe move us towards where we want to be? Right there, green shirt? You would just earn $2, right? So why do you think, my son's favorite president, right? George Washington, right there. I don't know why, but there you go. Thank you for answering that correctly. So yeah, a subsidy, right? A specific subsidy moves us towards marginal cost equals price. So let me ask you a question. The following policy proposal is being floated by a person you're considering voting for. I'm considering subsidizing Microsoft heavily so they will produce the socially optimal level of Windows operating system charged with price. Do you think that's a politically feasible thing to do? No way, right? Subsidizing monopolists, while it gets you towards the efficient output level here, it's just not doable, right? So what do we do? Well, in order to think about that for a second, we have to think about the types of monopolists we have, right? There are monopolists that are these traditional, you know, profit-maximizing firms that produce Windows or other products. But there are different types of monopolies that arise from different, you know, or sorry, let me say this in a way that I understand it, maybe you'll understand it. Monopoly power arises from different sources, right? So A, you could be a monopolist because you are the only firm that has access to a key input, right? So if you're the only country that has rare earths, whatever that is, you might be a monopolist of rare earths because you will control a key input to production, right? The other reason you could become a monopolist in something is you might be the only firm that knows how to produce a certain thing, right? Nobody else does, and if you can somehow prevent the knowledge of how to produce that certain thing from leaking to others so they take advantage of it and produce knockoffs, right? You have a monopoly over producing something. The third thing is substantial economies of scale, and I want to talk about that one for a second, sometimes called a natural monopoly, right? So what this means is that one really, really large firm can produce market output more cheaply than two firms half that size. So firms that have these significant economies of scale are firms that have huge fixed costs of building up their capital stock. So things like the people who bring you sewage services, right? They don't bring you sewage, they take it away, right? Cable television providers, people bringing power to your home. Industries like that where you have one really large firm that can produce aggregate output bigger than if we had two smaller firms. What do you mean, Max? This seems really strange. And it is a little bit strange. But let's think about this for one second. So let me show you what a firm like that looks like. So I'm going to draw average cost and marginal cost here. And I'm going to draw you some cost curves. Actually, let me draw this in blue. Average cost? Nope, I'll do that again, sorry. Average cost, and then marginal cost. So let's say we're in the long run. What types of firms are these? Remember increasing returns to scale? Right, increasing returns to scale have falling average costs over the range of production. You double inputs, you more than double output, right? So a natural monopoly here would be one where if the demand curve looks something like these here, right, let this be demand. If you ask this firm to produce the efficient output level, what that firm would do, the firm would produce where price equals marginal cost, so force this firm to produce the socially optimal output level, Q star, T star. That's socially efficient, right? Where would the firm produce if you left it by itself? So 2, 4, 6, 8, 4 here. If this here is marginal revenue, if left alone, the firm would produce right here, QM. Marginal revenue. And charge what? Whoa, are you ready for this? Go up to demand and charge this price. Same thing I've done before, right? All I've got now is I've got an average cost curve that's downward sloping everywhere, so increasing returns to scale everywhere, which means marginal cost is below. This is demand. This is marginal revenue. So marginal revenue equals marginal cost right here. The firm would charge a really high price. How would you feel if there was a monopolist that provides sewage services and charges such a high price that only half the households would get it? Now you can answer that question, but you wouldn't feel too great about it, right? So what do? Right? We try and take these industries that have natural monopolies to make sure that they produce the socially efficient level of output. Well, what is that? It's price equals marginal cost. It's that point right here. For my last dollar, why wouldn't that work? Who said it? So why wouldn't producing P star, Q star work? Let's say you could tell them you have to produce Q star and charge P star. That's the social optimum where price equals marginal cost. First dollar bill. Close enough, but that's worth a dollar, right? No, you take it. All right? It's not necessarily negative revenue. You still take in price times quantity, but at that price, what's your average cost of production? Well, go up and across, right? This here is average total cost of producing Q star. So your average total cost, if you charge P star and produce Q star, the number of dollars it takes you to produce Q star units is, on average, is lower than the price you get. So what would the firm do in the long run? Shut down. Would you like your provider of sewage services to shut down? Not in the short run, not in the long run, not ever, all right? So this can't be the right answer either, right? Even though it maximizes welfare, in real terms, this is a disaster because you end up with no sewage service in the long run. So what we actually do is we let firms produce, I'm running out of colors here, red, blue, black. We let firms produce somewhere here, okay? Where demand or price is equal to average cost. So we let firms produce where it costs them, in economic terms, exactly on average, as many dollars to produce the unit as people are willing to pay for it. So this is not the first best solution. This is in some sense a second best solution here, where price is not equal to marginal cost, but we let firms produce an output that's slightly lower than what's socially optimal, but it lets them break even in the long run. Now, are we forcing people to make zero accounting profits? No, we don't, right? In the real world, and investor-owned utilities, for example, the PG&E, SoCal Edison, San Diego Gas, Electric of the world, they're subject to very similar regulation like this, where they're asked to essentially break even, but they're allowed to earn a standard rate of return on their capital, right? So they're paid the full opportunity cost of using capital and so on, but they're not allowed to actually just produce QM and C, which would be profit maximizing for them. But we have something called the California Public Utilities Commission, which tries, and this is incredibly complicated, and armies of regulators and consultants and academics are busy in this, but which tries to get us to this point where we're producing close to the socially optimal amount of output at a price that allows the utilities to earn a regular rate of return, and consumers pay this much lower price. All right? Next time, one of my favorite models, monopolistic competition, I will finally explain to you why there are 99 types of low-fat yogurt in your supermarket fridge. So I will see you on Thursday.